Variable primary versus primary secondary pumping systems. In the industry, there has been a lot of debate about pumping and piping schemes used in hydronic system design. In general, variable primary flow is the growing trend and is considered to have the modest energy and first cost savings advantages, a smaller footprint and some added control complexity. While primary secondary system design is considered reliable, conservative and easy to operate. A typical variable primary flow system as shown in the figure has set of pumps working together to independently serve multiple chillers. Flow is allowed to vary through each chiller as chillers are sequenced in and out of service. A minimum evaporator flow bypass and normally closed control valve serve to maintain minimum flow through running chillers to prevent freezing in low and laminar flow conditions. The minimum evaporator flow bypass valve is sized for the minimum flow of the largest chiller. A study conducted and released by Air Conditioning and Refrigeration Technology Institute, ARTI, states this in its executive summary. Variable flow, primary-only systems reduced total annual plant energy by 3-8%, first cost by 4-8%. And life cycle cost by 3-5% relative to conventional constant primary flow variable secondary flow systems. What we should really focus on when taking the decision to go with variable primary system is the number of chillers. Plants with fewer chillers saves more in variable primary arrangement. Example: a building cooling plant with two identical chillers each sized for 50% of the peak load, and in a primary-secondary configuration. As the cooling demand moves beyond 50% of plant design capacity, the second chiller is activated, the flow in the primary loop is 100% higher than the secondary loop flow. B. Now consider a district cooling plant with 10 identical chillers, each sized for 10% of the system peak cooling load and in a primary-secondary configuration. As the cooling demand moves beyond 50% and the sixth chiller is activated, the flow in the primary loop is only 20% higher than the secondary loop flow. Variable primary flow is most advantageous when the following apply. 1. The cooling load and flow varies. The system is designed for variable flow and isn't intended for constant process cooling loads or full thermal energy storage. 2. Footprint is a premium. Variable primary flow systems reduce the footprint taken up by extra pumps, pipes and connections. Design considerations. Chillers should be compatible with variable flow. Chillers should be able to handle the pressure. In a large system, with pumps upstream of the chillers, the supply pressure may be high. If delta T in operation is low, it will be even higher. Primary-secondary pumping. A traditional primary-secondary system, as shown in the figure, combines a constant flow primary loop with a variable flow secondary loop. Primary pumps are constant speed and sized for the head and flow required in the primary loop alone. Secondary pumps are variable speed and sized to deliver chilled water through the distribution network to connected loads. In this configuration, a decoupler separates the primary and secondary loops. The flow through each chiller in the primary loop remains constant, while flow in the secondary loop varies in response to cooling load. To maintain design supply temperature, flow in the primary loop is maintained higher than or equal to the flow in the secondary loop. Primary-secondary pumping. When to use? It may be advisable when the following apply. Chillers can't handle variable flow or only can handle minor flow variations. This could be the case with absorption chillers. Chillers can't handle the pressure. It is a large system and the pumps are installed upstream of the chillers. Loads and flows don't vary. The system has steady process loads or full thermal energy storage. The facility owners, operators, engineers are far more comfortable with primary secondary. Thanks for your listening and hope you get some benefits. Please subscribe for more videos.